Good morning to everybody, and thank you so much for coming out. We're going to have a nice short program today. We've got some excellent speakers, and Father Sharp's here, but we're going to begin by presenting the colors of our country. This is the Abram J. Ryan Assembly. We'll start with the presentation of colors and the Pledge of Allegiance. Please remove your hats. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Again, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you everybody for being here. This is a beautiful day, and this is a beautiful cause. It's the cause of life. I'd like to thank the Abram J. Ryan Assembly and introduce Father James Sharp.
We begin with a prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you always for your precious gift of life, the protection of which you have trusted the men and women of your church throughout the ages. We grieve that so many people have failed to see the magnitude of that gift, which you bestow upon humanity every second of every day, from one end of our world to the other. We accept that you have chosen us to be a part of the mission to work toward the day when the tragedy of abortion is overcome in all parts of our world. We know that this will be a long and hard struggle, but we know also that you expect your people to stand against the sorrow of the taking of a single unborn life. Help us always to speak against this evil and to witness to the beauty and sacredness of life. Now we ask your blessing upon those who are here today, those who will give their time and energy in order to witness to the sacredness of life. Bless their efforts here and wherever and whenever they will witness to the beauty of your truth. Through Christ our Lord. And now may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you always.
Let's give a round of applause for Father Sharp. Now, the next person we have coming up is Carol Everett. Carol's the mother of three, the grandmother of six, and she has a story she wants to tell.
Thank you, and thank you for coming out today. Nicer day than we could have had. Very nice, very cool, breeze, no sun. And you're going to be able to stand for something today that you believe in. I can't tell you how much I appreciate that, but I also want to tell you about what's happening across town in abortion clinics while we stand here for life. I've been there, sadly, and I want to open the door this morning for you. As I was coming, I was thinking about what I should say, of course. And I was thinking about something I never said. I don't believe I've ever taken the time to talk about what might be happening today very early in an abortion clinic. My job would have been to provide the food for the day because those people were going to work through lunch because we expected anything less than 40 was a bad Saturday. So 40 plus, we would have at least two doctors working in the abortion clinic. So there were several things I had to think about. I had to think about lunch for the staff of about 15 plus the doctors. I had to think about cooking at the clinic, or could the women smell that, and how horrible would that be for those women who couldn't eat to be smelling our food. I also only had 21 sets of instruments. Now, that may not mean a lot to you, but if you have 40 or more patients and you only have 21 sets of sterile instruments, you have to think about two things. Can you sterilize the rest of those instruments, or will the doctors be working so fast that you don't have time to get the temp to clean the instruments, get them in the sterilizer, bring the temperature up, leave them in there for 20 minutes and cool them? You're not going to have time. So some of the women that day are going to have abortions with instruments that are not sterile. So you get your staff going and you bring everyone in early because you don't want the doctors waiting. We didn't care that much about the women, sadly. We cared about keeping our doctors happy because our doctors wanted to sail in at 9 o'clock, do 10 to 12 abortions an hour each, and leave. And that's what I concentrated on. The better and more efficient the clinic worked, the happier the doctors were, and of course it was important to keep our doctors happy. We'd worked all week to telemarketers to sell those abortions, to get them booked, and now was the day. Of course, we did abortions 7 days a week. When we got there at 7:30, the women were waiting. They were nervous. They were scared. We would get them in, take them to the lab. They would do their pregnancy test, and they would be shown the pregnancy test because it's a powerful sales tool to see your positive pregnancy test, and they would go to the front and pay. If the test was negative, there was a different sales technique. We simply said to that woman, look, this test is negative. You could still be pregnant. This, you know, this early, you don't know. You want to know for sure today, don't you? So she went back for the sonogram, checking all the way to be certain she didn't raise sonograms for a living, because when we put her on that table, we could put every man in this room, every child in this room on the table, and find what we would call a pregnancy, because we all have bubbles in our abdomen. We'd find a bubble, lock it in place, and say to that woman, there it is, you're pregnant. Do you have your money? And she would go up to the front and pay. When the doctors came at 9, the rooms were loaded. That means every woman we could possibly get in was up. There were two teams of two assistants with each abortionist. And the first team set up the first young woman, and the doctor would go in there to do that procedure, while across the hall the second team set up the second young woman. And when he finished that first abortion, he went across the hall. He didn't do a surgical scrub. He didn't stop to do operative notes. He started, regloved, did that second abortion while the first team got the first girl out, cleaned the room, and got girl number three up so he could run back and forth across the hall and do his 10 to 12 an hour. That went on until the day was finished. And then I would go to the front where the doctors would bring their receipts. You know, you didn't know which doctor would do which abortion that day. So they simply collected a receipt off the chart. They would bring them to the front. We would pay them in cash, no 1099, no W-2. I'm sure they reported it all to IRS, don't you think? And when they left, I went to my office, and I put the number of abortions we'd done up in the right-hand corner of a monthly calendar, and I circled it, and in my head, I multiplied it by 25, because if we did 42 abortions today, I made $1,050 because my commission was $25 for each abortion. And then I went home. It was a lonely life. It was a sad life, but someone came into my life and made a difference. Someone was bold enough to tell me that Jesus Christ loved me. He loved me no matter what I'd done, and he died on the cross for my sins. And by this act of faith in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, my life could change. And I prayed that prayer, and changed my life it did. For the first time, I saw that I was selling death, not life. I saw that I wasn't helping women, I was hurting women, and I knew there was a better way. You know, I didn't walk out of that abortion clinic a wonderful woman. I walked out a hurting woman filled with the lies I'd believed to get me there. And months, days, years, the Lord worked on me to show me the truth. And today, what I'd like to do is to encourage you to go away and multiply. Now, when we say multiply and when we talk about life, we all think about having babies. But that's not all it is, you young people, particularly for you. There's far more than that. When I say multiply, I say to you, find a friend that doesn't believe what you believe and share the truth with them. You know, we don't win much debating, but we do start the thought process. So if you can tell people that a baby's heart is beating at about 21 days after conception, if you can tell someone that you believe when that baby is conceived, it is alive because those cells are immediately multiplying. If you can talk to your friends right now about not having sex until they're married. You know, there are a lot of things, a lot of lies that we all believe. And there are a lot of lies thrown at you, young people, because they want to get you. They want you to believe the lie. They want you to believe that you can have sex outside of marriage and that there's no complication for that. Well, I know that in this area, there are probably several of you who really don't want to go home and talk to your parents about sex. But trust me, your parents don't want to talk to you about sex either. But you know, your mother and father are the people that love you and are responsible for you, and they are the ones that you need to talk to about sex. So understand it. Talk to your parents about that. Get the truth. Go to the White Rose. See what they're doing. Talk to all of the wonderful pro-life organizations within the Catholic Church. You know, the largest pro-life organization in the nation in a diocese is right here in Dallas. The Catholic Pro-Life Committee. Yes. And they have information for everything. So go over there and educate yourself about what's going on. Know what you can do. Understand what the Lord has called you to do, for He certainly has a call on your life because you're here today. And then answer it. And let's start multiplying for life among our own area of influence, among those we go to school with and those that we visit with. And when you hear someone's having sex outside of marriage, talk to them about the consequences. You know, we all hear about all the horrible sexual transmitted diseases. We hear about AIDS, but no one talks about the fact that sex outside of marriage tears a girl and a boy's heart completely apart. There are so many complications to that that no one talks about. So understand those and then go forth to help other organizations. I'm glad you're here today because you see, Tom Clark just told me that the Knights in the state of Texas are leading the entire nation in helping crisis centers. And I don't doubt that for one minute. Obviously, we should be more active. This is where abortion started. This is where we want to stop it. But be involved in a new way. For this, my friends, we now have. We have the strongest law in the state of Texas and in the nation that is already closing abortion clinics before it goes into effect. We have four tenets of that law. It says no abortion 5 months into the pregnancy. Now, I know some of you probably thought that didn't happen, but it's happening, and this, Dallas, is one of the big baby abortion centers of the nation. So that's going to stop. It says that if that doctor is doing abortions, he must have admitting privileges within 30 miles. Now ask yourself this, would you want to have outpatient surgery with a doctor who couldn't admit you to a hospital in case of a problem? No, yet women are having abortions every day not realizing the doctor is not qualified to completely care for them. That will change. It also says that if you're having RU486, it must be given according to FDA standards. Now why is that important? Well, today, the FDA standards are that you can only use RU486 for 49 days for 7 weeks, yet the abortion industry is stretching it to 9 weeks. They are not caring for women. These are simple, simple medical practice standards that are being put in effect in abortion clinics in Texas. Those will be effective January 1, although yesterday they filed the first challenging lawsuit. They did not challenge the 5-month rule. I guess they thought that would look too bad, saying that they wanted to do abortions at 5 months, but the 30-mile rule were challenged, and the FDA standards, and the most, I think, of course, it was mine, so I love it, moving abortion clinics to ambulatory surgical facilities, I'm sorry, I think is going to close a lot of them, and they told us it would, and that goes into effect September 2014, and we have already seen three abortion clinics close, one closed before. The White Rose here in town is already has three facilities, and they're next to abortion clinics, so they're ready to take care of those women. We are seeing the caring arm of the life movement move to full well woman clinics with natural family planning. We're seeing the pro-life movement move to take care of every facet of women, so it's time for us to be aggressive, because I firmly believe that the law that was put in place when fully implemented will save 40,000 babies' lives a year and every year thereafter. We have work to do to take care of those girls and women. So get along. Sit down in a quiet time. Somebody told me to get in a closet and close the doors, and I tried it and it worked. Ask the Lord, pray, and say, what part do I play and what do you want me to do? And when He answers that, move forward. I want to take just a minute to tell you why I'm here today. I am one of those women who wrongly got pregnant when I was 16. That was a long time ago. But life was different. And then the choices were different. You had the baby, or you disappeared into a Catholic maternity home where you would be cared for, and you were so ashamed that you changed your name. The father and I took responsibility. We had that baby, and while I was on the delivery table looking at this beautiful blonde little boy, his father went to the front office and named my son Joe Bob. I really don't know what I expected. His name was Jim Bob. Joe Bob is married to Carol Everett Jr. They have the first planned pregnancies in our entire family. They have a son who's 19. They have a 17-year-old daughter and a 16-year-old daughter. You see, they planned two and had one surprise. God got them. They had two 11 months apart. Trust me, with a 19-year-old, a 17-year-old, and a 16-year-old, their hands are full and they deserve it. My daughter is too much like me to talk about. She too is married. She has a 15-year-old and a 12-year-old and an 8-year-old. And perhaps the reason I'm here today is because of my third pregnancy. Because you see, I'm one of those women who made the wrong choice and who had an abortion. That's the one I can't smile about. That's the child I can't be happy about. But I will tell you this. I came to the point that I named her. She was real to me, though I couldn't see her. And I named her Heidi. Now, that name has derivatives of noble in several languages, but that's not what it means to me. It means hidden, for she's hidden from you. But she's why I'm here today. We have a lot of work to do. You've taken a big step by being here today, and I thank you for it. I want you to be joyful as you leave. I want you to leave with great joy, because we are winning. We're winning for two reasons, and it's clear that we're winning. If you were one of those who was fortunate enough to be in Austin this year and see God's people step up and stand for life when Texas passed that impossible law, you know we're winning. But we're winning, remember, for these two reasons. First of all, we're on God's side. He wins every argument, no matter what. And the second reason we're winning is we're the only side reproducing. Look around at all these wonderful babies. It's just a matter of time before we overtake them. God bless you. Thank you for all you do. And go hike for life. Take care.
I'd like to introduce Tom Clark, who's the Knights of Columbus State Pro-Life Chairman. He's got a little gift he's going to give Carol.
Good morning. You know, I don't know how deep they're going to get into the history of the Hike for Life, but you know, this is the 40th anniversary of the hike, so give yourself a round of applause for making history. Standing up for life for 40 years is a pretty impressive thing. Thank you for being part of that. One of the things of the hike is we have a special gift if you reach that $150 level, and that's a little meditation cross. Inside this cross, there's a relic. It's a piece of cloth that was touched to the tomb of Christ, the Holy Sepulchre. It's very special. This particular cross has been blessed, and I'd like to present this as a gift and as a thank you to Miss Carol Everett. I carry one of these whenever I'm in front of an abortion clinic praying. It brings a lot of peace to my heart. I hope it brings a lot of peace to her heart as well. God bless.
So I've been chastised now by Tom for not telling you the history of the Hike for Life. It started in 1973. It's the oldest pro-life event, as far as I know, in the country, definitely in the great state of Texas. We raise all of our funds go directly to crisis pregnancy centers. They're now called pregnancy resource centers, a little better name. So I'd like to recognize a couple people that are here. We have Christina Kane, who's with the White Rose. We have Tom Clark, you've met with our state pro-life assembly. We have Mike Hill, who's the Grand Knight of the Great 799 Council, right down the road here. And we have Jim Walker from CPLC. Forgive me. Thank you, Jim. But all the funds we raise go directly to the people that have their feet on the ground, that are helping with women, that are having a hard time making that decision of what do I do if I'm pregnant. You should go to the people that you trust, your parents, and you go with people from your church and people with authority that know what they're talking about. Not go to the pretty named places called Planned Parenthood and the other ones, because they will deceive you. So let me do a little housekeeping before we start our hike. Our hike is going to go down this path right down here to the big flagpole. We're going to say a brief prayer from the flagpole when everybody gets assembled. Then our hike will proceed down the path down towards White Rock Lake. We will then come back and you can just kind of follow me. There is water, refreshments. When we get back, there will be hot dogs. We've got all kinds of food. There are bathrooms out by the road. You can go now or you can catch them on the way back. And when we come back, we're going to have a good time having hot dogs and food. So if you have any questions, the guys in the blue volunteer shirts can answer your questions. And I'd also like to recognize one of our knights that's not here. He passed away. His name's Chris Matera. He was the main driving force. He's the vice president of Hike for Life. He's been on Hike for Life for a long time. Chris's picture's up here. And he was a great knight, so say a prayer for Chris while you're walking. Thank you, and we're going to go that way. You guys just follow me, and thanks once again to our Color Corps, Carol Everett, and Father Sharp. Thank you.
Chill.